Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to our webinar on warehouse management. I'm Jimmy Moore and I'll be joined today by my colleague Enda McKeever. We're both members of the Supply Chain Solutions team in West Northern Ireland. This webinar is a series of webinars and you can access all of them or register to join them on our Invest Northern Ireland website. If you have any questions, can you please attach them to the chat box during the presentation? And it's a fairly long presentation, so we will try to get to all of them at the end of the webinar itself. So without further ado, I'm going to let Enda take you through the presentation.
Good morning. The subject we're covering today is around the basics of warehouse management and the important vital role in delivering business efficiency and cost effectiveness. I'm Enda McKeever, and along with my colleague Jimmy Moore, we are part of the Supply Chain Solutions team at Invest NI. We are a team of experienced supply chain professionals. Basically, what we do is help businesses to develop their supply chain function to enhance value. So how do we do it? It's a three-step process approach of scoping, delivery, and support. So in that process, an opportunity to understand the business and key problems. We help to build plans to address these areas, covering the capacity, opportunity, mapping, and assessment, supply chain specialisms. There is an opportunity in step three to add a key worker, and Invest NI will support businesses with that. Okay. More to learn on this in this particular webinar on that detail. So the essential function that an efficient warehouse process plays in the delivery of a smooth and efficient material flow through a facility will ensure that the delivery of the right part at the right time in the right place, ensuring you can maximize the capacity of your operational activity and the efficiency of your team. So that this presentation will touch on the elements required to deliver that outcome. So by the end of the webinar, you will understand what best practice is, critique where you are, and how you might improve. So firstly, however, the starting point is safety of your people, and their safety should be your number one priority. And we know that in a busy environment where people, machines, and material are moving, there are inherent dangers. So in the slide here, it illustrates some data statistics from UK 2018 to 2019 in the warehouse environment. Maybe surprisingly, the least one is the lifting and carrying at 7%, but some of the usual things, slips, trips, and falls at 45%, and falling from height and struck by a falling or moving object. So these are things obviously to be of great concern in that type of environment. So it's important that you know what you're handling. It could be chemicals, it could be bulky, it could be something that requires abundant storage facility, so store it appropriately. Separate personnel from vehicles, ideally where you can have logistics highways for vehicles to move, separated from a pedestrian walkway. Look at the use of doors in and out. Can you have a separate personnel door? There is a function obviously for the use of clear signage, helping to keep people safe using a visual warehouse. And ultimately, good housekeeping is a very strong contributor to safety in that area. So one potential tool is the 5S discipline. So good warehouse processes have a direct contribution to make to the business success. And so that how is that? Through cost, the service provided, sustainability, and cash flow. So good warehouse management will reduce your direct costs, right part at the right time. It will reduce your indirect costs, the use of your people, the use of your buildings and hardware, the overheads, the picking and pack and dispatch. The optimization inventory helps to improve the cash flow by reducing the amount of material that's tied up, your cash tied up within the business. And of course, there's some side effect in terms of the environmental impact that this process has through energy loss, the use of a good environment for people to work in, using electric forklifts rather than diesel and putting fumes into the air. Possibilities for solar panels on the roof space. These are large, generally large warehouses and a large roof space, so it may be appropriate to add some panels, photovoltaic or solar panels, and maybe the site would allow for wind turbines. So some things to think about on that one. There's 8 basic elements to successful warehouse management, and we'll touch on each of these in turn in this presentation. So those are obviously the actual warehouse and inventory organization. So the smooth flow of material into the site, receiving that new stock and the put away. On the outbound side, to pick and dispatch as quickly and as efficiently as possible. We'll speak to kitting, which is a process that can be particularly useful in support of operations and a good pre-check for availability of material. So that's something we'll deal with. We will also touch on measuring and improving performance. The use of automation, so that comes in many forms. Touched briefly on obsolescence and cycle counts as useful processes that support maintaining a good, healthy warehouse material management process. So I suppose dealing first with the first of these on the warehouse and the inventory organization, how to organize your warehouse for efficient process. There are 4 parts to that. I suppose the most important steps in optimizing your warehouse operations to make sure you have everything in there arranged in the most efficient way, and we'll deal with that within the presentation. So the areas we're going to touch here are on the warehouse layout, location, marking and labeling, arranging the inventory and rearranging it as need be, and keeping current by that rearrangement. So part A of that, the first part is dealing with the layout. So warehouse layouts, layout tends to evolve over time. So they've been added to over time incrementally in response to business growth. Often this is not optimal. So a total replan of the flow of material from end to end, from material into the finished product, can often yield major efficiency improvements on the business. So designed to create easy flow from gate to gate, can reduce high amounts of non-value and the activity associated with the handling, the picking, the moving, the decanting, the kitting, and the put away. So on the notes here, and so balance between the storage space and working space. So it's important receiving your, you have an area to receive your stock, to unpack and book it, to pack an area for shipping station, as well as excess dead stock area as well. And we'll talk a little bit about obsolescence. You need obviously somewhere as a warehouse office to do the transactions electronically, and a main storage space. So those are the main parts of that layout. So they do the exercise as a team to include those upstream processes. So on the slide here, showing different configurations, a U-shape, an A-shape, and an L-shape. So the general idea is to make sure that there's a natural flow, that you're not doubling back on yourself, and where possible, where the location allows it, to have a separate inbound to outbound. Okay, so they and the importance here is just to draw it out, plan that space for optimization, pick the right equipment, make sure that your aisles are wide enough so you can safely use them. Obviously, you're trying to maximize the use of that space, but optimize the use of multiple storage locations if you have those. And the important thing is that the material that you're moving most frequently is closest to the point of consumption. So those are things to think about as you redesign it. So recognizing that, obviously, you're constrained by the site that you're on. it's important to make the best use of that site with those restrictions. So as you make your plan, the advice here is to try and come up with various configurations that help to tease out the options and drive for efficiency. Okay, so these are the list of things that you need to include here. So as you draw the layout, understand what works well and what doesn't. Use this as a basis to develop several configurations. The advice here, as I say, is to at least three and maybe more, and then to blend those as you develop it. Best to do it as a team, using the full breadth of the team to make sure that you've got the inputs of the guys on the inbound as well as the outbound. So that layout should include inbound and outbound routes, receiving area, storage area, areas to pick and kit, material routes and personnel routes, and just what works well and what needs improved. So those are things that are best captured in that process. So the location and the marking is just as an important, again, important element of any warehouse. And again, with the history of a warehouse, you tend to put up more and more signs. It comes to the point where it's very hard to read an area. So the labeling should be very plain, very clear. So just as you plan, choose the right types of label materials, plan the pick paths and the sequencing. Number the shelves from the ground up, and obviously the reason to do that is that you may want to add height at a later date. So if you number from the ground up, you can avoid a relabeling. So the numbering and lettering of labels needs to be sequential. So it is best practice to use a serial and all numbers are less than 10. And again, this is used for that sequence to be properly ordered within a computer system. So lack of consistency in labeling is an easy way to mess up your system. So the advice here is make it plain, make it clear, and just make it minimum to do what you need to do, and make it a picture that has that's easy to read by even people who are not familiar with it. So a little here on just a location mark, and this is an example here of one, but again, this example may not necessarily work for you in particular, but it would depend on the size, the weight, and the number of locations required as to what works best for you. So just looking, clear labeling, as I've already spoken of, and visual, and design for growth. So you've been growing maybe to this point, but that journey doesn't stop, and there needs to be room to expand further. It needs to be robust to staff turnover as well. So people who are not familiar with it, it should be plain and easy for them to pick up. The example given in this slide here draws you in to the number, to an aisle, to a unit within that aisle, and to a shelf. So that's at 03BE02 in the bottom left-hand picture. Equally, it may have smaller parts. You may need to do further separation and go to another row to break the shelving up. But again, it needs to work well for you. So the detail that you use and need should be applied universally and maintained. So one of the things, and again, just a reminder that all operations are non-value-add activities. So that's something that your customer is not paying you for. So therefore, should be minimized as an activity. So therefore, the greater need to minimize these by, with activities such as decanting and picking, walking and transport. Those of you who reflect on the seven lean wastes, the warehousing and logistics process would touch directly five of those, and maybe one indirectly. So things like transportation, the excess of inventory, motion, people walking, waiting and delays, and over-processing. So those are key things that you want to minimize. And quite often too, it indirectly would touch on defects, because the more times that you lift material and move it, there's an opportunity for it to be damaged, paint damage and other types of damage. So one of the things to consider here, that typically 60% of a company's parts part needs come from about 20% of their products. So that's the material that you want to be closest to you. So that the idea is to try and reduce the picker walking time by identifying that 20%. Store them as close to the packing depths as possible. Use the height to maximize that cubic volume, and store bulky products in the lower shelves, basically for safety reasons. Align the layout with logistics equipment, so the equipment needs to fit within the aisles and be able to be worked safely. This is essentially about the efficient use of your warehouse personnel. I'm putting stress on the need to continuously adjust and review based on changing business demands. And the examples here, the first one is about, I suppose, arranging your inventory in three groups, A, B, and C, where the least frequently used is A, furthest from the picking area. So it's just zoning off your warehouse as to the material that you need to get your hands on most frequently is closest to the point of pick, therefore reducing the time. So that's one strategy. The second example brings another level of complexity to that, which looks at the, I suppose, the fluctuating demand. So parts may be picked in significant volumes, but they don't have that constant demand. So therefore, you bring a different factor into your arrangement. So it would be perfectly reasonable to start with a strategy similar to the one on example one, and then over time move to example two to drive further efficiencies and use it as part of your continuous improvement. But again, this has to be tailored to suit your business and the physical layout within your warehouse. So keeping current by rearranging. So this is part of your continuous improvement process. So an optimal arrangement for the warehouse it doesn't really stand the test of time. So you need to move with that. So demands in the warehouse will change depending on that customer demand. The seasonality in some businesses is a big factor. Production needs, again, those can change. And say, for example, if the sequence of build within an assembly process can change, so therefore that puts different demands on the supply. Staff and equipment changes as well, and obsolescence and shelf life. So some things to think about in that process. This one here illustrates a useful tool to try to identify material that is picked more frequently. So how would I know what my high runners are? So this particular one here feeds information possibly from a warehouse management system or an MRP system on what gets picked most frequently. So just to highlight that, and then to use a heat map to indicate where those particular parts within the warehouse are. So using that information, then it's easy to start to segregate and to move material that requires that higher utilization to zone it off, to coordinate off and bring it closer to the pick area, therefore reducing the inefficiency of long walks and collecting stuff from the high levels. Some things to think about. So moving on, just to touch on the inbound side, so we're receiving new stock. Efficiency in receiving and put away can make a very large contribution to the operational efficiency, the overall efficiency. So the impact on shortages, quite often material arriving is in quick demand from within. So the quicker that can be put away, the better. Also, receipt inspection should be part of that process. So have you received it on time and in full? And particularly where there is a high dependency on MRP, it's important that that's done accurately. So 6 in 10 warehouses will deploy radio frequency identification by 2028. So that's a useful tool. It's a relatively cheap process, but it helps to drive a higher level of efficiency, of accuracy, which is essential where you're very heavily dependent on MRP. So plan the receiving area for efficiency. Make sure your transactions are accurate. MRP is an absolute must. And minimum touches, as we already talked about, avoid decanting where you can, ensuring that your suppliers are sending it in a container or a box that you can put directly to the storage area, and establish a first in, first out. So that's just good policy to ensure that material is getting turned over, and that quite often can be impacted by if the material has got an age or a life on it, or if design changes with production. Quite often then material can become obsolete. So importantly, you're using it in an actual FIFO within you, so your storage area is designed to allow that to happen. Using next technology we've already spoken to for speed and accuracy, and typical tool using barcode scanners, the radio frequency identification, or the QR. So things to consider. On the outbound side, the strategy you currently employ tends to develop as the business grows. So when there's a demand on the process multiply, there comes a point where you need to change to a system that is optimized for your business. Just discussing here four different options of those: single order picking, batch picking, zone picking, and wave picking. You can see in the matrix the strengths and the weaknesses of those. So we'll deal with each of those in turn. And so it's an important consideration to get it right for your own business. So firstly, the single order. So this is basic picking method, typically only used by those who are just starting out. And a picker will pick one order at a time in its entirety before moving to the next one. So this one here would be best at startup and for low volume. So to be avoided if you're picking more than 20 orders a day or plan to in the near future. So that will be your entry level, and quite often is the most frequently used. But as a business develops and gets matures, then quite often it's time to move away from that one. The second of those, the batch picking. So the picker in this case is assigned a batch consisting of a number of orders. So picks them all in one go and then returns to a set down area. The number of orders allocated to each batch is generally between 10 and 30, but this really depends on the physical size of your product and the average order size. So this one is best when you're doing a high number of orders with a single or low number of products per order. So high number of orders, but not so many products within the order. Avoid it if you have a high number of products per order or are aiming to do that in the near future. On zone picking, the third of these, just in this particular graphic, so each picker is assigned an area, picking in that zone only. An order is passed through all areas to have items added to it by pickers in that zone before being returned to a drop zone. So this is great for preventing pickers getting in each other's way, but it can delay shipping of each order passes around the warehouse. So this one's best for businesses picking a high volume of multiple item orders. So, and then avoid it if you typically pick single or low item orders or have very few pickers. So that might be an overkill in that case. So, okay. The way of picking, the last of these is similar to the zone, but all zones are picked at the same time. This is to try and reduce that total time through it takes to put an order together. So a packer will consolidate all them separate picks for each order. So this one's best for businesses picking a high volume of multiple item orders and still wanting to maintain a super fast process. So if time is of the essence, this one may be the most suitable for your business. Avoid this one if you're typically picking a single or low item orders to have very few pickers, or cost is more important than speed in that instance. So it's a balance. Obviously, if you're getting the timing right, you need more people to drive the process. So some things to consider, what's right for your business. So just a few things to reflect on, the picking and the dispatching of stock. So what method do you use today? What's the correct one for your business? And how can the efficiency of the method be measured? So those are a reflection of your business and where you should or need to be or will want to move in the future. So dealing with the process, Kitting, I've already talked about the non-value activity. So every time you touch a material, and it's a non-value added activity. So material supply should drive to reduce the number of touches required to deliver components to the point of use or the consumption. Kitting's another touch in that delivery, so should only be considered where it's necessary. So thinking about the pros of that. So parts are delivered upstream in the right quantity, the right time. So there's some efficiency. This is concentrated on the upstream process, making sure material drives efficiency in that area. So it's also a very useful availability check. So that's an early warning if there's any stock out issues or material that needs to be quickly found to support production. And it's a good way to manage and control your stock. So the con of that, as I said, is it's an additional task. So if you have a process that is very consistent and efficient, you may not need that, and it's only adding a non-value activity that's adding to your cost. So why and when for use? So a large number of parts required upstream to protect the upstream process or to reduce operational inefficiency. So a few examples there listed. The first one is Mitsubishi Heavy Industries, and this was an aircraft wing. So huge number of parts. That kitting process was essential to ensure efficiency on the operational side. So kitting off site, bringing them in, feeding them into the process in a sequence to a timed process, was able to, number one, control the material, ensure parts were available prior to the actual build, and getting the best out of your operations. MRI scanners, another good example, where they used a trolley system to bring material in sequence, already having it kitted, and with both the parts, the installation tool and the fasteners on that kit trolley. Another one, air conditioning units at Hitachi. So there are many other examples, but again, the discipline driven with kits can really make a contribution to that efficiency of the operational space. So at the end of the day, that's where the value added is, and well worthwhile putting that in where the application is needed, okay, to drive the discipline. Okay, the example then in this one, just a trolley. We're calling this good kitting practice and poor kitting practice. You can see an example on the left, nicely laid out material and the sequence that is required, and working from the top, going to the right, coming into the bottom level, and going from maybe right to left in that example. Also, because you're using a shadow board, it's very clear that there's a couple of parts missing. So putting the time into doing this properly can, again, drive benefit. You've got a very useful visual tool to identify parts that are missing from that particular one. You also notice that there's a set-down area, an area set aside. So again, an aisle discipline. And so taking it to that level takes a lot of work, but can drive some significant benefits. The example on the right-hand side, very useful trolley in a sense that you're carrying lots and lots of parts, bringing them in time, but less clear about are there shortages on that or a sequence. So maybe a bit of an overload in this example, and although it may well deliver all parts at the right time, you cannot necessarily be sure, at least looking at that you've got a trolley loaded in the right way, and even safely for that matter, with the potential that parts will fall off. So something to think about in terms of that as well. Okay.
So thanks, Enda. Now that Enda's given you a good understanding of how you can physically set your warehouse up for best results, I'm going to go through an address how you can ensure the right levels of control, performance, visibility, and process improvement to make sure they're in place in your warehouse. We start with KPIs. There are many warehouse KPIs you can choose from, but the best practice will be to make sure you cover the broad areas of health and safety, customer, inventory, and efficiency. And it's already covered what you need to do for health and safety, so I'm going to focus on the other three. For customer KPIs, you should at the very least cover delivery and pick quality, and that'll give you a good idea of your ability to meet the expectations of those who depend on the parts in your warehouse, whether that be an external customer or your own factory for kitted parts. You may also want to use leading rather than lagging customer KPIs, such as back order rate or aged order rates, and that'll give you an early warning that you know, that your delivery process is not performing, instead of waiting until you're actually field for your customer. Second KPI area is with inventory. Inventory accuracy for me is one of the most important metrics in a business, in a business that holds stock anyway, and an area that you should be continuing to improve. If it's not managed well, it can have an impact on all the areas of customer satisfaction, planning effectiveness, supplier performance, overhead efficiency, factory efficiency, and your company's stated profitability. If your systems state that you have a particular item of stock and you don't have it, it's really down to luck as to how much damage that can cause. In addition to that, fixing inventory accuracy issues can be a complex task involving lots of different parties and lots of different departments in the business. So the sooner you have a good idea of how good or bad it is, the better for you. Another important warehouse KPI is inventory turns when you're looking at inventory. This is something that warehouse operators don't know warehouse management don't own, but it's certainly something you should be aware of. It's calculated as your annual cost of goods sold divided by the value of stock and materials on hand. And this will show you how long the parts and materials in your warehouse are kept before they're being used. So how long they occupy your shelves. The targets will differ basically depending on what industry sector you're in. If you're making electronics, it'll be very high. If you're engineering, it'll be slightly lower. But a good minimum target is to turn your stock 6 times per year, which means that if you've got a 60-day payment term with your suppliers, that'll ensure that you're balancing your purchasing cash outlay with return from manufactured products. Finally, we've efficiency KPIs. As most of the warehouse costs are in pick and overhead, it makes sense to focus on those and to measure something like your daily pick rates and what's your space utilization is. Target for picks, that'll depend on your product or materials mix. So a good approach is to use a benchmark for what you know is good and work from there, just from your own experiences. For space utilization, it's about making sure you're utilizing your occupied shelves as opposed to making sure you've got all your shelves full. So if your occupied shelves are less than 60% full, in other words, you know, half of it is you're wasting a lot of space that could be used for demand fluctuations or any planned growth that you have. And it'll probably mean that you're going to have to take warehouse space on and pay for it that you wouldn't have to. Next area covers automation and digitization. If, as you're measuring your efficiency and accuracy, and your KPIs are stagnant and process improvement techniques aren't really delivering what you think it should, or they're not delivering anything, it's probably a time to consider using automation or digitalization for some of your processes in your warehouse. There's a lot of solutions, there's a very wide range of solutions, and what I've seen is it can be very difficult to figure out where to start. So to aid in your decision making, it's definitely helpful to categorize the different solutions so you can understand what's available. Basic warehouse automation refers to technology, simple technology that assists your people with the tasks that would otherwise have to require manual labor, basically. An example is a conveyor or a carousel moving parts from A to B. Warehouse management system is very prevalent. These are software and data analytics that automates the tasks in the warehouse, tasks and procedures in the warehouse. An example is an IT system that can batch your pick lists, so all orders can be filled in a time period, and it sequences the pick lists so the pickers don't have to traverse the warehouse back and forward and waste time and resource doing that. Then you've mechanized warehouse automation. It's basically where a warehouse automation uses robotics equipment and systems to assist humans with ordinary warehouse tasks. Example is autonomous mobile shaft load robots. They'll lift products and deliver them to the human pickers who are sitting at the picking station, prevent walk time. And finally, there's the more advanced warehouse automations, which it combines all of them. It combines mechanized warehouse robotics and automation systems, and focuses on actually replacing labor-intensive human workflows in the warehouse. Examples of this are robotic forklifts that use AI, cameras, sensors to navigate the warehouse, and also your warehouse management system to pick and deliver the parts to the pick station. And also what's referred to as a dark pallet warehouse, where basically there's no lights in it. It's where a large volume of pallets are received, pulled away, and picked again without any human interaction. Whatever automation approach you take, some important things to consider are, first, that automation must be cost justifiable. I will also decide the budget very early on, and definitely decide the first, and know what returns you expect from the actual investment. Second thing is to be clear on is it's basically whatever problem you're trying to solve, to be clear on whatever problem you're trying to solve before you embark on any automation and digitization projects. It's not uncommon to find yourself in a situation where you've got this technology and you have to go looking for a problem to fix. Some very common examples of a successful digitization solutions are, as I described, warehouse management systems, voice picking, and augmented reality picking, which are also referred to as AR. Warehouse management systems, these are really bolt-ons to your company's existing ERP system, and they help you pick effectively, increase inventory accuracy, and provide management information reports to show where you're doing well, where you're not doing so well. Many of them assist in pick sequencing and mobile scanning for receiving and picking, and both of these things improve efficiency and accuracy in your warehouse. Mostly involved easy access technology. It's very prevalent, it's out there. You can buy bits and pieces to yourself if you've got coding capability in your company. And implementation isn't difficult for that reason, but it can take a lot of time to set up, and you have to spend time to make sure that it's right on the side. Voice picking is a fairly recent technology, and it's very effective in large warehouses with lots of SKUs, basically reducing a lot of looking and searching and walking time. It uses software to guide a picker through the warehouse in the most efficient path. It's ready to determine what the most efficient path is, and tells them what to pick, reduces searching time, and it also increases pick accuracy. AR picking, it involves the same principle. It basically has a tablet, which basically guides the picker to the right location, and that can include a validation check, which basically checking the parts and the location versus what the things it should be doing, and two scans, and that can further improve pick accuracy. As with the warehouse management systems, these solutions they're widely available technology and hardware. You can buy bits and pieces to yourself, as I said before, and it's not difficult to install. However, setup time is very significant because you've got lots of parts to set up in these systems, and they must be continually maintained for data quality. If the data quality isn't right, it's just going to be wrong. Next story is around the management of obsolete stock. Product obsolescence is a risk area for any business that holds inventory. If you have to write off or downgrade stock, it has to come off the bottom line. That means for every pound of stock that you write off, and your net margin is 20%, you're going to have to sell 5 more to make up for that loss. So it's very expensive. It's vital, therefore, that you have a good, robust, defined process that you use regularly to look at obsolete stock. First of all, to make it visible. Analyze what the risk is in pounds and pence, and then have an approach to deal with it. How you deal with it, it's once the risk items are visible, you can take actions like design changes, basically to use the obsolete parts and parts you wouldn't have otherwise done it. Speak to your supplier about returns if it's still within date. And then at the minute, nowadays there are lots of online and physical auctions where you can go and try and sell it. Finally, another process you should look to employ in warehouse is cycle counting. It's linked to your inventory accuracy, which, as I said, is very, very important for any business. It's fairly easy to introduce in that you can choose what suits you. You can choose the sample size and the time in the week or the fortnight, whatever it is that suits your availability. and also what suits other parts of the business, because you do have to shut things down for a couple of hours to do it, and that can disrupt production further upstream or further downstream. You can also choose to focus on items that are greatest risk. You don't have to do every part all the time, or you do random cycles. You can basically choose your risk parts, and those risk parts are the ones with, if the stock is wrong, such as long lead time parts or high value materials, it'll be a large business impact. Basically, you design to suit yourself. So most modern IT systems, they facilitate set accounts, but you know, I've dealt with a good few companies where it doesn't, and if it doesn't, it's fairly easy to put a manual process in place, but it's definitely worthwhile doing it. And over and above the obvious benefits of better accuracy, reduced costs of the larger stock takes, introducing this regular type of check to your warehouse, it brings a Kaizen-like culture of a continuous review and an improvement culture, and that will have a wider impact on the overall performance of your warehouse. So that completes what myself and Enda consider to be the best practice for warehouse management. There's probably other things we've missed, but I think for the purpose of this webinar, that covers most things. To summarize then, the approach that we think you should take is, first of all, to look to arrange your layout and organize your inventory to suit what your business needs. Make sure your people have defined roles and processes, which is just standard type stuff for all businesses. Measure performance, due to your KPI as well, and spend time to fix the recurring problems. Use technology where it's feasible and it's cost effective, and that will definitely improve your standards and improve your efficiency. And finally, make sure you've got risk areas like stock accuracy or obsolescence, make them visible and don't hide them in the corners, as happens in a lot of warehouses. So what are the next steps? A good starting point is to take some time to do a bit of reflection and review your warehouse functions, the processes, your setups, yourself physically and from a process point of view, and ask yourself whether or not there are areas that we've covered in the webinar here today where you can improve. And then if the answer is yes to that and you would like some support from our team of supply chain experts, feel free to contact us you can go to our supply chain support solutions webpage. If you go down towards the bottom of it, there is a supply chain solutions online inquiry. Just click on the button, fill it in, and somebody will be with you shortly. Okay, so now myself and Enda will answer a few of your questions, and then maybe if you stick your camera on there. So the first question, Enda, for yourself, that's come up here, is somebody sponsored, my warehouse has evolved over time and we are restricted on site. Where should I start to optimize? So maybe if you could address that.
Okay, thanks, Jimmy. Yes, the one thing that's important in this is that at the end of the day, the customer is keen. So I talked within the presentation about what's value add, what's non-value add. A warehouse function is very definitely non-value add. So to be minimized, alignment with the value adders, the operational piece of it, or if you're going directly to the customer with the product, are what's key here. So from the point of view of looking at a warehouse, you can use operational changes to drive significant change within a warehouse. And looking at the flow of material from gate to gate, essentially, so make sure that everything is joined up. We talked again within the presentation about good layout, allowing that to minimize flow, walking distance, and so on. So from the point of view of when do you look at it, my suggestion is obviously is at a point it comes where you've driven the change to the point where you're not making any further gains. That might be the time to review and plan for a significant change. How to do that? I would suggest you look at several options, build a team around, use the breadth of the team, and look and see what options can be worked on, you know. So if you have two or three good options, those can be blended and come up with the optimum. So that is required in most businesses as it grows at maybe certainly two or three times within the 10-year period, a significant change to make sure you're getting the best out of that warehouse. Not easy to do. You will be restricted by the physical site and the need to keep production going. But a lot of gain is possible, and certainly to take the pressure off a hard-pressed team.
Okay, and just kind of in your own experience, you know, that you were saying about getting teams together to try and figure out, you know, get the experts to figure out where the optimization can take place. How often would you have done that in your experience?
We tended to, I suppose, my background is one of the major employers. We tended to do this as part of an alignment with an operational change, so that you were looking at it from the material in the gate to the material going out the gate. So this typically would have happened on 2 to 3 year cycles, a significant change. Within those, of course, you're looking for continuous improvement, and that's more like an incremental improvement. So you wanted to build a culture within the warehouse team of looking for improvements every day, every single day, every week, every month, you know. But that can only be taken so far. And there does come a point you say, look, we really need to have a major realignment here to allow us to make further gains.
Just somebody has popped in the question just while you're talking there, and it's related. That's this. My warehouse is also a workshop for assemblies and servicing. So how would you advise optimizing that type of warehouse?
Okay, so again, I'll make the comment is that the one thing that gets number one priority is operational efficiency. There is a level, obviously, that you can take that to. So my tendency would be to give precedence to the operational piece, and that the warehouse essentially swings off that. If you're in a fast moving environment where there's attack time, then that becomes the heartbeat of the process, and the logistics operation needs to be in timing with that. So yeah, whether you're using a kitting process or feeding material directly onto the line through a Kanban type process, that's your starting point, and everything else then has to swing off that, if you like.
So the optimization really should be focusing on getting visibility, first of all, what's required for those two real value streams, and then work back from that to see what's there and why do you have it, maybe. So
that's absolutely right, Jimmy. It's about connection and connecting to the end customer on the outbound, but also your internal customers as well. So that gives you a chance to make material flow properly. Do minimum touches, travel less distance, all those things that are driving total non-value added and driving inefficiency.
So a related question here that came in earlier, how do I know when my warehouse is performing at a high level?
Yeah, it's an interesting one. You know, if you're not in a position where you've measured your performance, there's very obvious ones about the use of the facility, first of all. That's about how good you're making of use of the space. So it's one of the things you mentioned in your part of the presentation about taking a measure of the percentage utilization. There's two ways of doing that. One is utilization based on the number of used pallets within a warehouse, okay, and you tend to hit higher numbers than that. Or others will measure, and probably maybe a better way of measuring is by cubic volume of material stored as opposed to cubic volume of space that you can store in. And the reason to do that is that sometimes people putting shelving up, there's too much space between those shelves. So therefore, you're using a pallet, okay, but you're not using it as efficiently as possible. So if you use the latter as a method, that tends to drive improvement, and you give yourselves targets to do that. In that environment, if you're given 25%, somewhere between 17% and 25% utilization is probably optimum. Higher than that, then you're impeding people's safety. Lower than that, you're not getting good returns. That's one thing. The other one then is about, we talked about walking distance and efficiencies are driven with that. So there's other key metrics there about order fulfillment and the efficiency of that. So the starting point here is start, measure it, see how you're performing, look at it over time and drive improvement. If you're not measuring it, you won't focus on it.
Yeah. Okay. So one other question here, we're kind of running out of time here. So I take this one. It says, what are the digital tools that bring best returns for least investment? So for me, I kind of alluded to it in the presentation as well, is the most important thing in a warehouse is inventory accuracy. You know, we've got costs, you know, overheads and walk time, you know, number of pickers, that type of thing. But it is definitely the case that if your inventory isn't accurate, you have got such a huge impact across the business. So if you've got a factory, it means you've got downtime because the materials aren't there when they need them. You've got a purchase department who are constantly expediting because you thought out the parts and they didn't. And then you've got your finance department who are saying, well, why are we having to get rid of all this stock at the end of the year that we thought had most value because you've got too much? And that's because, you know, there's something turned up in the stock take that you didn't think that you had. So for me, the technology that can bring a better improvement to that is the one that you should consider at a very basic level. You know, again, as we said, it was doing cycle counting or doing some sort of regular counting, whatever you want to call it, is very, very important. So if you are able to get a bolt-on onto your current system, a warehouse management bolt-on, or you an addition to your current warehouse management that facilitates easy cycle counting, and you know, sometimes systems can be basically they can prevent you from doing it because they're too bloody complicated. Like, so something like that, that's very simple. That's in low thousands of pounds, would be able to make that change in a bit of time within your warehouse. Beyond that, then it's actually probably the most effective low cost option is to look at barcoding and scanning within your warehouse. So it's something that the physical parts of it, the actual barcodes and the barcode scanners and the setting up of it, the software isn't overly expensive. You know, the prices have come down significantly in the last 15, 20 years from what it used to be. It used to be an expensive option. So you're now talking about, £5,000 to £10,000 who you can invest in a bit of software and get your scanners in for a small medium sized warehouse. And that means that everybody is scanning everything in and scanning it out. There is a lot more time in setup and making sure that the setup is correct. If you don't set your systems up right in the first place, then it's still going to be wrong, which basically defeats the purpose. But it's not overly expensive to implement, but it is a change in people's attitude and people's approach to things as well. So that's probably the bigger change. Beyond that, then you're into 5-6 figure sums into some of the more detailed, really smart type systems that are going to do things for people and remove by removing the human input to it altogether. But certainly from the average SME, get a warehouse management system that can do cycle counting and has got decent procedures, and also implement barcoding and scanning if you can. That would be the advice for myself. So if you've anything to add, Enda?
The only thing, just I'm looking at the process. Where are the manual interventions within your process? And ask yourself the question: Can I automate those? Because those manual interventions are tending to drive inaccuracies and using people very, very poorly. You want to, where you can, have data transferred automatically. So that's a starting point. Again, then the final question you have for yourself: if I invest to do that automatically, what's my payback? So everything has to be cost and a return. And some of that, some of the technology we talked about is relatively cheap and probably well worth investing in it, certainly as you grow.
Okay. Well, we've come to the end of our hour. It's not usual for us to fill a full hour, but obviously it's a big topic and lots to cover. So thanks very much, Enda, for your input and for answering the questions. And thank you for everybody who's attended for coming today. And as I said, just check out our websites and see, there'll be more webinars coming up in the next while. So make sure you check our website to see what's coming up. And hope you enjoyed it. And thanks very much for attending.
Thank you.